I get asked all the time what mini mill I use, what mill do I recommend, and if I would buy my mini mill again if given the chance. This video is my best attempt at answering all of those questions, and it's also a head-to-head comparison between the Harbor Freight Sieg X2D mini mill and the beefed up version from littlemachineshop.com. As a custom knife maker, I use my mini mill all the time for making tools and fixtures, drilling holes, milling guard and spacer slots, milling in my hidden tang shoulders, and a laundry list of other tasks. Having a mill is extremely useful for the knife maker, and buying one for my shop was one of the best equipment-related decisions that I've made. Before we dive into the head-to-head, I feel like some context is necessary. First off, the mills we're talking about today are all of the mini variety, meaning they are small and compact bench models designed for the hobbyist or for small jobs. In my opinion, this just so happens to be a great size for a weekend warrior knife maker. Specifically, we're going to be talking about the Sieg X2D line of mini mills. Many companies offer these mills and they have varying features and quirks, but they are not all created equal. You can buy a Sieg X2D from Harbor Freight, Grizzly, Clutch, Winn, Micromark, Eastwood, and probably a few other companies that I don't know about. However, if you want the best, most robust version of this mill, the clear winner is the High Torque model from littlemachineshop.com. The Little Machine Shop version comes with numerous upgrades, and we're going to get into those details in this video. The good folks at littlemachineshop.com have been watching some Redbeard Ops videos on YouTube and decided they were tired of watching me use a subpar Sieg X2D mini mill. So they offered to send me a High Torque Model 3990 mini mill to test out and review. Partnerships and video sponsors isn't something that I do frequently. However, when I do, it's with a company and on a product that I already know has a stellar reputation. And Little Machine Shop is no exception to that rule. While watching this video, it may be useful to pull up the product page for this mill as a visual reference, so I'll have an official link in the description below. With that, let's get into the review. The mill will arrive at your location on a truck with a liftgate. The gentleman delivering the mill used a pallet jack to cart the mill into my shop, which was very convenient. The shipping took less than 5 business days, and the trucking company called me on the delivery day to let me know when they were on their way to my shop. Getting the mill off the pallet was fairly easy with a crowbar and a hammer. You're going to need a 14mm box-in wrench and a 6mm Allen head wrench to unbolt the mill from the crate. I used a furniture dolly to slide the mill on top of and then carted it to my bench. This mill weighs around 140 pounds, but it's more awkward than heavy. A shop crane or a cherry picker would really come in handy here, but with some effort, it's liftable with manpower as well. When I lift these mills, I try to take great care not to lift them by the cross slide table or handles, or really anything I think could get torqued when lifting. Basically, I try to get my hands under the castings by carefully rocking the machine. These mills are imported into the United States with a fairly heavy layer of grease applied to them in order to negate the chances of corrosion. So I took a little time with a paper towel and some WD-40 to clean off the mill. This mill comes with an accessory kit that includes wrenches, handles, and a crossbar. The first thing I did was install the handles for the X and Y tables so that we can move them around. But that's pretty much all the assembly required once this machine shows up at your shop. To get this mill set up properly, the foremost thing I needed to do was check and adjust the tram, which in layman's terms is just the squareness of the spindle to the table. This makes for a perfect segue into our first point of comparison between this mill and the mill from Harbor Freight. The mill from Harbor Freight, along with most of the Sieg X2D mills on the market, come with a tilting column. I'm sure there is a use for this feature, but I personally have never used it. For me, and I think for most using these mills, the ability to tilt the column is actually a major weakness. This nut and spring washer opens up the possibility for movement of the column over time, which will result in your mill being out of tram. For this reason, I actually built a spindle square so that I could check my tram frequently with the Harbor Freight mill, especially before performing an important operation. The High Torque 3990 solves this problem by having a fixed column. Not only is this column fixed, but the wall thickness in the column is significantly thicker than the standard column on the Sieg X2Ds. With a set of calipers, I measure the High Torque column wall thickness to be around 445 thousandths of an inch, while the Sieg X2D wall thickness was around 259 thousandths of an inch. This is a 72% increase in the wall thickness when moving up to the High Torque mini mill. Since the column is rigidly attached to the frame, tramming is a little more involved than the tilting column. However, you should only need to do it once. From the factory, I'm showing a variance of around 5 thousandths of an inch, over 7 inches on my table with a DIY spindle square. This is right on the edge of spec for these machines, however, I figured it couldn't hurt to dial in the tram with a shim kit from littlemachineshop.com. Since I'll be tightening and loosening the column bolts multiple times, it makes sense to mount your mill before tramming the head. I drilled and tapped some holes into my workbench, which has a piece of 3/8 of an inch plate as a tabletop. I use 1/4-20 fasteners for this, but note that the holes are significantly larger and can accommodate larger bolts. With the mill being securely attached to the workbench, I'll start the tramming process by inserting the dial indicator arm into the drill chuck. This will allow me to get readings on each side of the table. We'll start by tramming the X-axis, then tram the Y. On the X-axis, I had a total variance of 14 1/2 thousandths of an inch. I cut the shim stock into U-shaped pieces so that they straddle the bolts attaching the column to the base. This worked very well for when I made mistakes and had to move them around. I can be pretty dense, and I actually put the shims on the wrong side multiple times during the process, resulting in me moving the spindle even more out of square. The good news is that these shims are fairly easy to move around and install, so it wasn't a big deal to move them to the other side. I started off with the largest shim in the kit, which I think was around 5/1000ths of an inch. This got me most of the way there with a total variance of 4/1000ths of an inch along the entire X-axis. This is well within the specs of these machines, however, I figured since I'm here, I might as well use the thinner shims and get a little closer. By the time I was done going back and forth with smaller shims, I had the X-axis dialed in to 2 1/2 thousandths of an inch. After you have the X-axis done, you can repeat the process on the Y. Within about an hour of time, I had a mill that is pretty darn trammed. My back left corner is the lowest, so I'll use that as my zero. The front left corner came in at 1/1000ths of an inch taller, the front right corner was 3 1/2 thousandths of an inch taller, and the back right corner was 2/1000ths of an inch taller. So the total variance diagonally through my table was around 3 1/2 thousandths of an inch. That's more than square enough for what I'm doing with this mini mill for sure. So now we'll move on to some of the other differences. One noticeable difference right out of the gate between these mills is the size of the table. The table on the Sieg X2D from Harbor Freight measures 15 1/8 of an inch long by 3 9/16 of an inch wide, whereas the table on the High Torque measures 18 1/16 of an inch long by 4 11/16 of an inch wide. That works out to an increase of around 57% in the total usable table area. However, not only is the table bigger, it also has more room to run. You can notice this by looking at the footprint of these mills from the side. The High Torque is longer in the Y direction. To roughly measure this difference in Y travel, I used a Sharpie and a square to mark my welding table at both ends of the Y axis range for each mill. The Harbor Freight mill had a Y axis total travel of 4 3/16 of an inch, while the 3990 had a total travel of around 5 5/8 of an inch. This works out to a 34% increase in the Y travel for the 3990. To get our measurement on the X axis, I moved both tables to their maximum extension and measured the overhang. The Sieg X2D had an overhang of 9 3/16 of an inch, while the High Torque had an overhang of 11 15/16 of an inch. This works out to a 30% increase in the X-axis travel. Lastly, let's measure the Z-axis max height from the table to the spindle. The High Torque had a max Z-axis range of 11 1/2 inches, while the Harbor Freight mill with the installed air shock kit had a max Z-axis range of 10 13/16 of an inch. It's worth mentioning here that when we converted the Sieg X2D to the AirShock from the torsion spring, there is an increase in Z-axis travel in both directions, both towards the top position and towards the table. But even with that AirShock installed on the Harbor Freight mill, the 3990 still has an increased travel of around 6%. I think this is primarily due to the superior location of the Z-axis travel stop on the column. This extra height is really handy when working with hidden tang handle blocks, and I plan on using the extra long end mills to slot my handle blocks in the future. So this increase in Z-axis travel got me excited for sure. The air spring tensioning system is standard on the 3990, with the normal Sieg X2D models coming with a torsion spring on the head. This was the first major upgrade I did in my Harbor Freight mill, since I hated the inconsistent and weak tension provided by the stock torsion spring. I found the air spring really helped out when using the fine feed on the Z axis. The High Torque comes with a belt drive system built into the head of the machine. Most of the Sieg X2D mills come with plastic gears inside of the spindle head, and my Harbor Freight mill was no exception. These plastic gears are pretty loud during operation, and they're also weak. I recently broke the plastic gears inside of my mill and was able to fix the problem by installing a belt drive kit from Little Machine Shop, which was a big improvement over the stock Harbor Freight gears. The brushless 500 watt 0.67 horsepower motor on the 3990 is also beefed up in comparison to the 350 watt 0.47 horsepower motor on the standard Sieg X2D mills. The circuit board is also upgraded to handle the stronger motor. A few years ago, while I was building my surface grinding attachment for my 2x72 belt grinder, my circuit board blew out on the Harbor Freight mill. I ended up finding a guy to send it off to in order to get the board upgraded and repaired. However, I was not happy at the time with the mill. This is one reason why I was reluctant over the years to review and endorse this Harbor Freight Sieg X2D mini mill. With the 500 watt motor and VFD on the 3990 mill, you will not need to switch between high and low gears like you do on the standard plastic geared mills. The dial on the high torque ranges from 0 to 2500 RPMs, and I was shocked to hear how quiet the operation of this mill was, even at the highest speed. I'll throw up the torque curve on the screen for both the Sieg and the high torque. The takeaway here is that you will have a higher torque across the whole range of RPMs versus the standard 350 watt motor that comes in the Sieg X2D mini mills. And the torque is for the most part flat up to around 50% and declines in a linear manner from 60 to 100%. This relationship is what negates the need for a high and low gearbox like seen on the normal Sieg X2Ds. There are also a few miscellaneous improvements with the 3990 that I'll mention here. Firstly, I really like that the X-axis gib lock is located off-center. I found with the Harbor Freight mill, my vise was often in the way of this lock being operated easily, so this is a nice feature. The power switch on the 3990 seems to be of higher quality, however, time will tell on this, and I'll make sure to keep you all updated if there's ever any issues. One thing I really like about this high torque model is that the ends of the X-axis are made out of metal. The plastic end on my Sieg X2D actually broke a few months ago, so this is also a nice upgrade. In reality, the purpose of this video was really just an introduction to the high torque mill and its features versus the standard Sieg X2D. When it comes to using the 3990, I've only had time to mess around with cutting some aluminum, which was a breeze with a nice sharp face mill and a half inch roughing end mill. The operation of the cross slide tables was really smooth, and with the reduced noise of the internal belt drive system, it was a real pleasure to use. I will be using this mill going forward for the majority of milling operations during my knife builds. So if you want to keep up with its performance and capabilities, make sure to stay tuned by subscribing to the channel. I'll also be putting a link to this mill along with some other products from littlemachineshop.com that I have used in the description below. I hope you all really enjoyed this comparison, and if you did, please consider hitting that like button down below. If you have any questions about this mill, I'll do my best to answer them in the comment section below. With that, like always, I'll catch y'all on the flip side.